Good morning. Welcome to worship. We're glad you're here on this Sunday morning. And while we certainly want to keep all those people in our prayers that were affected by the storms, we are thankful this morning that we are able to be here this morning and didn't have any devastation from the storm. So we thank God today for that. I do have just a couple announcements. On March 11th, we had an event here called New Places for New People. I think we had over 90 people attend from the district. There is going to be a follow-up event this Tuesday at the Atlantic, First United Methodist Church at 6:30. So you're invited to attend that. New Places for New People, follow-up this Tuesday at 6:30. And just a reminder for you to mark your calendars. It was in the newsletter, but just so you know, 2 weeks from today, which would be the fifth Sunday, April 29th, it has been designated as Camping Sunday. Following the service, we will have what we call a camping meal in Fellowship Hall. And then in the afternoon, those who are able, we will go to the library and do a community project there, helping to clean the grounds for the public library in town. So just mark your calendar for that, please. And today in the bulletin, you had the little insert, the one for the Native American offering. Today is one of those 8 Sundays as United Methodists that we take these special offerings. This offering will be used to support Native American ministries, also to help with scholarships for Native Americans that are attending schools of theology to become pastors. So if you feel called to give to this ministry, you can place it in the offering plate today. And I do want to thank Edith Haynes' family. The flowers are here from her memorial service yesterday, so if you please continue to keep the family in your prayers. And I do want to just welcome everybody. I know we have some visitors today and family, so if family want to share about those joys during the joys and concerns, that would be great, but we do welcome everyone today. If you'd like to stand now, Sharon's going to lead us in our praise songs. Oh, how he loves you and me, and he is exalted. Please stand.
Good morning, everyone. I think sometimes after Easter, we've kind of put aside that it's actually happened, and we need to always remember that in those weeks that follow that glorious rising, he loves us so much, and we need to always have in our mind that that continues on from week to week throughout the year. Did we lose it? I think we had to reprogram. There we go.
He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. I will praise him. He is exalted.
Can we turn up the mains, please?
Exalted, and I will praise his name. He is the Lord, forever his truth shall reign. Rejoice in his holy name. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. I will praise him. He is exalted, the giver exalted, and I will praise him. Exalted, the King is exalted on high.
Thanks, everyone. Please be seated.
Join me in the call to worship. This is the day the Lord hath made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
This is the day the Lord has set apart. This is the day the Lord has blessed.
Let us rejoice and be
thankful. Turn to page 98 and join us in singing, "To God Be the Glory." You may remain seated.
Please join me in our prayer of confession. Be gracious to us today, our Lord, for we are in need of your mercy. We are often quick to doubt and slow to pray. We are tempted to let go of faith when we need to hang on. We are discouraged by wrong when we need to be encouraged by the power of your Spirit, O God, our loving Lord. Give us strength to trust in you all the days of our lives. Amen. It's time for our joys and concerns. If you want to raise your hand, and we will have a time to do that.
Well, I'd like to introduce my grandson, Niles Scott Craighead. And we got Molly and Scott here, too.
Welcome and congratulations. Thank you.
And I would likewise like to introduce our grandson, Lou Joseph Gambiana, and his mom, Kim, is here.
Welcome. Congratulations to you also.
Our aunt Jackie has been diagnosed with lung cancer, and she started radiation last Monday.
We will keep Jackie in our prayers. Thank you, Calvin, for sharing with us.
mine are not here in person, but I can't outdo these. I've got three. And Riker came home yesterday, so all three are home, and we are very, very thankful.
Oh, congratulations, Tim. Wonderful news.
Mark and I are a great aunt and uncle. Mark's niece, Chelsea, had her baby on Tuesday, a little girl, Rylan Teresa.
Congratulations. Lots of new little ones.
Well, we're happy to announce after a year, our grandson Tyler is out of Afghanistan and back in Alaska, and we only hope and pray that all the troops return safely.
Thank you. So good news.
It is getting that time of the year that we're getting ready for Vacation Bible School, so you're going to hear from me and probably Christy quite a bit. Don't forget to save your cans, because we have the can kennel for the month of May, so have those parties and drink up. Soda, yes, soda. And then I'm going to be passing around a couple of bulletin or clipboards.
Thank you.
With asking if you'd like to volunteer, or if you want to donate food, or just whatever you could do to help us make this a successful Vacation Bible School. And Vacation Bible School will be Sunday, June 10th through Thursday, June 14th this year, in the evenings, and we will do a light meal, just like we have been doing.
Thank you.
I have a concern and a joy. My brother Daryl was in an accident this last week, a tractor accident that somebody slammed him from behind. He was taken to Red Oak Hospital and then life flighted to Creighton, and he has the C1 and C2 vertebrae are cracked, and he has had surgery and has a nice collar now. We are very grateful for the doctors who are available, and especially small town rescue units, because they made the big difference, and a trucker who was meeting him that called 911 immediately. So we are blessed, even though, you know, that's the way. So prayers for him, please. He was going to need some, a lot of recovery time.
For Daryl, thank you.
Yes.
It's my dad's birthday this week.
Your dad's, right, the 19th, right? Happy birthday, Mark.
Okay, I have a letter from Children's Square, and I don't know if you remember when. We took a collection, and we went shopping, and I can't remember what I report and what I don't. So I'm just going to read this to you real quick. Dear friends at the Oakland United Methodist Church, thank you for your donation of new underwear, socks, and backpacks. With the number of children we serve, socks and underwear are extremely important for us to have on hand in every size. Children in our program range in age from birth to 18 on campus, as well as young adults that have aged out of the foster care system. Thanks to your generosity and the support of other friends like you, we are able to serve 550 children and their families each day. Your donation allows us to provide a variety of services at our main campus in Council Bluffs, as well as our sites in Sioux City and Omaha, Nebraska. In addition, we recruit, train, and support resource families in both Iowa and Nebraska, and currently work with over 500 foster and adoptive families, as well as relative homes that are caring for children. Thank you so much for your caring. Bless you, and thank you for meeting our special needs. And we gave 59 pairs of ladies' underwears, girls or ladies, 40 pairs of men's, 88 pairs of socks, and 49 backpacks. So you should all give yourselves a round of applause for that.
Thank you for sharing that with us, Misha. Yes, and thank you for all of your donations. Anyone else have any joys or concerns today? I would ask, too, if you're in your prayers, if you would keep Larry Beckendorf in your prayers as well, please. Let us bow our heads for a time of silent prayer. Dear gracious God, you are such a faithful God. Your love for us is eternal. There's nothing we can do to have you love you more, have you love us more, or nothing we can do that will lessen your love for us. Your love is perfect. We confess we are not always faithful to you, God, not as faithful as you are to us. We sometimes seek things and we look toward people before seeking you first. Help us to put you first in our lives, God. We thank you so much for your patience with us, God, and your abiding presence. Help us this day and always to be open to your Spirit and the changes that need to be made in all of our lives in order to more closely follow you. God, we do thank you today overall we've been passed by for the storms that went through last night, and we do lift up to you all those communities that were affected by the storms, and as far as we know, at least in this area, we don't know of any loss of lives, God, so we praise you for that miracle with such storms that we haven't heard of any loss of lives, so we praise you for that today, God. We want to lift up to you, God, all those folks that have illnesses in different ways, have needs that they need your healing touch in their lives. We pray for Daryl, God, and we do thank you that there are those people right there to help him and that he's been getting good treatment, God. We just pray for continued healing for him. We lift up Larry to you today and his family. Be with him, strengthen him, courage, heal him, God. Just touch him with your healing hands, please. We pray for Jackie for healing, strength in her treatments that are to come, God. Be with her. We continue to pray for baby Livia, God, for healing. We pray for all our members of our government, God, just that in their hearts they would seek you and put you first in their lives and know that we have to continue, God, to put you first in our country. We pray for all of our church family and remember the military and thank you for those who have returned. And again, we do pray for safe return of all of our military personnel. We continue to pray for those who have lost loved ones, the family of Madeline, the family of Edith, God. Be with them, comfort them, assure them that their loved ones are with you, God. We lift all these prayers up today to you, God, and just thank you for the joys that you give us, new babies. Such a blessing, God, and we just thank you that your miracles never end, God. Every day there's a new miracle in our life when we look and see and realize that they are from you. So thank you, God, for your goodness and grace in our lives. Be with us this day and always. Pray these things in your Son's name. Amen. Will you please join with me in praying our Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. It is now time for the children's message. If the children would come forward, please. Good morning. You beat me here, didn't you? I was a little slow. How about if I scoot in there somewhere? Would that be okay? Don't step on anybody's fingers. There we go. Okay. Good morning. How's everybody today? Are you doing good? You look good. Yeah, you look good. Okay, well, you know what? I've got something in my bag, and I'm going to talk about it, and I'm going to pass it around. There's some pictures, and they're not real big, so you can just pass them around and look at them, okay? There's a picture of a little boy named Katuta, and another little boy named Abaju, and a little girl named Yolando, okay? So you kind of look, and I don't know if you'll see that there's something that all of them have in common, meaning that there's something that they're all alike, and you know what? It's not a very good thing. I will let you just look. Just kind of pass that on down and see if you look. You know what? All those children, they have a problem. Their legs don't work. Their legs don't work? No, they don't. How about when you first were born and after you got a little older, what did you do before you started walking? Crawled, right? You know that. And then pretty soon you could walk, right? Well, these two boys and that girl, you know what? They never could walk. Never could walk. The only way they can get around is if they crawl, and that's because two of them had like a disease called polio. And you know, you boys and girls get a vaccination. You get a shot in the arm, so you don't get polio. We don't get that in this country, but in other countries far away, they don't get the shots when they need them. They don't have the money and they don't have access to them. So you know what? They get diseases like polio, and then it affects their leg, and they can't walk, yeah. And one of the children was born that way. Their legs and were just crippled when they were born, so they couldn't walk. So you know what? They live far away in another country, and so they can't even get around.
She didn't pass it to me.
Okay, well, we'll pass it that way, okay? So what would you feel like if you could only get around and crawl? What would that be like? Wouldn't that be terrible? It would be hard.
Because you might not be able to get up on things.
That's right. You couldn't get up on things. It'd be on the ground. How about, is the ground pretty dirty?
Yeah.
Yeah. It's just terrible. And you know what? What do sometimes in this country people use wheelchairs? You know what a wheelchair? Okay. We'll get it to you. Okay. You know what a wheelchair is, right? Well, you know what? In those countries where these children are, wheelchairs don't help because, you know, the wheelchair wheels are kind of small. They live in places where the ground's really rough. They don't have nice cement, and they don't have nice flat surfaces. They're rough roads, and the wheelchairs would just kind of tip over. And also, they have to have somebody push them because they could never afford the ones that would push a button and they go on their own, you know? So these poor children, some of them couldn't go to school. They couldn't really do anything because they were very limited. So, you know what? Yes?
They need one of those things that's out there where you do the things with the hands. And it's kind of like bike.
Well, you know what? Some missionaries, and those are people that go to other parts of the world and tell people about Jesus, they saw that there were all these children and adults too, men and women and children that couldn't get around, and they felt so bad that they came back to the United States where we live and found somebody that could make something to help them get around, and it's called a pet. So you know what? We've got one here today. There, Hayden's going to bring it in. Watch him. So see, even if their legs don't work, it's okay. They can kind of crawl up in it themselves. And then look at, all they have to do is use their hands. And it has big wheels. See those big wheels? So it can go on rough roads. It can go on muddy roads that have deep ruts in them and they won't tip over. And they can just go wherever they want. What do you think about that? Isn't that pretty neat? And they make them here in our country, and then they ship them over to places, and they give them to boys and girls and men and women. It makes their whole life different. Could you see that they could just get around anywhere with one of those? And you know what I read about? It was a neat story about a man who hadn't ever been able to walk, and he couldn't make a living. He couldn't earn any money, didn't have a job. And you know what he did? He got one of those, and he kind of put some extra shelves around it. And you know what? He put chips and pop, and he went around to the little villages and sold it. So now he could even have a job. Isn't that something? He went from not being able to walk and do anything to be able to be moving himself and then to even have something to make a living. So you know what? I'm telling you this because next week, not this Sunday, but next Sunday, we're going to take an offering here in our church for this. It's called a PET. You'll remember that word, right? It stands for Personal Energy Transportation. Each letter stands for something. So do you think that's pretty neat? Isn't that a good thing to do? Just think how happy the boys and girls and men and women in other parts of the world that can't walk are happy when they get one of those. It changes their whole life. It really does. It'd be just like you crawling around everywhere you went and all of a sudden somebody gave you one of those. How would you feel? Great. And it'd be like freedom, right? You could go where you wanted and you wouldn't have to depend on anybody else to help you. It's a good thing. So that's what we're going to take an offering for. So isn't that pretty neat? Thank you, Hayden, for bringing it in. That's great. How about, can we say a prayer? Can we pray a prayer? Dear God, thank you for loving us. Help us to be able to help others by giving money to buy things like a pet. Amen. Oh, thank you for coming up. You did good. You did good, listeners. They started making those, let's see, it was the late 1998, I think. So about over 10 years anyway. Over 10 years. They've been making those for over 10 years. You were right, right. And they have adult and children one. That would probably be an adult size, I think, but they have children size. Thank you, Hayden, very much.
I don't believe this is up there. The scripture lesson this morning is from 1 John chapter 1, verse 1, through chapter 2, verse 2. It can be found in the Pew Bible on page 1481. I'm reading from the New International Version. That which from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked at, and our hands have touched, this we proclaim concerning the word of life. The life appeared. We have seen it and testify to it. We proclaim to you the eternal life, which was with the Father and has appeared to us. We proclaim to you what we have seen and heard, so that you may also have fellowship with us. And our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We write this to make our joy complete. This is the message we have heard from him and declare to you. God is light. In him there is no darkness at all. If we claim to have fellowship with him, yet walk in darkness, we lie and do not live in the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, purifies us from all sin. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just, and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. If we claim we have not sinned, we make him out to be a liar, and his word has no place in our lives. My dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anybody does sin, we have one who speaks to the Father in our defense, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for ours, but also for the sins of the whole world.
Will you please stand for the reading of the gospel lesson from the Gospel of John this morning? This is chapter 20, verses 19 through 31. Jesus appears to his disciples. It was late that Sunday evening, and the disciples were gathered together behind locked doors because they were afraid of the Jewish authorities. Then Jesus came and stood among them. Peace be with you, he said. After saying this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were filled with joy at seeing the Lord. Jesus said to them, peace be with you. As the Father sent me, so I send you. Then he breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive people's sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven. One of the 12 disciples, Thomas, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, we have seen the Lord. Thomas said to them, unless I see the scars of the nails in his hands and put my finger on those scars and my hand in his side, I will not believe. A week later, the disciples were together again indoors, and Thomas was with them. The doors were locked, but Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. Then he said to Thomas, put your finger here and look at my hands. Then reach out your hand and put it in my side. Stop your doubting and believe. Thomas answered him, my Lord and my God. Jesus said to him, do you believe because you see me? How happy are those who believe without seeing me? In his disciples' presence, Jesus performed many other miracles which are not written down in this book. But these have been written in order that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through your faith in him, you may have life. The word of God for the people of God. This is God's good news. While you are standing, we're going to join in singing, O Jesus, I Have Promised. If you're using the hymnal, it's on page 396. Seated. Well, if I were to mention some certain words to you and ask you to write down or say the first word that comes to your mind, there would probably be some common answers. So we're going to try that now. I'm just going to say a word or two, and anybody just say out what comes to your mind first thing. Okay. Laurel and Hardy, okay. The rolling, as old as dirt, and Methuselah, right? Either one. Dancing with the Haley's, doubting, there it is. Poor Thomas, right? What a word to have attached to your name, literally for centuries. Just think, still when we say doubting, one of the first things we think of is poor Thomas. In the first three Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, we don't really learn a whole lot about Thomas, very little in those Gospels about him, but it's John's Gospel that we heard from today that we learn more about Thomas. There's another chapter in John that talks about him. It's in chapter 11, and maybe I'll just kind of tell you a little bit about this one, and maybe it will come to your mind. It's when Lazarus was sick, and remember, his sisters called for Jesus to come to heal them, and Jesus purposely detained going for a couple of days. And then when he finally said he was going to go, his disciples said, oh, Jesus, you know, you can't go. Remember, that's the place where you were before, and they said they were going to stone you, you know. You can't go back there. That's what the disciples were saying. But then Thomas said these words, "Let us all go along with the teacher so that we may die with him." Now, that sounds like a pretty courageous person, right? Thomas said those words, but we don't remember him for that, right? We could say courageous and then say Thomas, but he didn't get remembered for that. Nor do we remember the significance of what happened when Thomas actually did see Jesus in our gospel lesson for today. Thomas said, "My Lord and my God." What he was really saying was that he understood about the divinity of Christ. He got that Jesus was also God by saying, "My Lord, my God," but we don't attribute that to him either. Unfortunately, history has mostly remembered Thomas for the scene that I shared with you from the gospel lesson for today. The resurrected Christ had made his appearance to his disciples in a home in Jerusalem, and Thomas wasn't there. So when he heard from the other disciples that Jesus was alive, he said, "You know, I'm not going to believe that till I see for myself." And then the second time Jesus appeared, Thomas was there, and he saw, and he said he believed. A man fell off a cliff, but he managed to grab a tree limb on the way down. He was hanging on to it very tightly, crying out for help. "Is anyone out there?" All of a sudden, a voice, a very strong voice, said, "I am here. I am the Lord. Do you believe me?" "Oh, yes, Lord, I believe. I really believe, and I can't hang on much longer." God said, "That's all right. You have nothing to worry about. I will save you. Just let go of the branch." There was a pause in the conversation, then the man shouted, "Is anyone else up there?" This man believed in God, but he just wasn't sure. He obviously had some doubt as to whether he could trust God or not. And most of us can relate, right? We believe in the promises of God, but trusting them is a little harder. Although the scriptures clearly tell us over and over that God will take care of us, most of us worry from time to time. We worry about our resources, if we're going to have enough money to take care of ourselves or our family. We worry about always having the necessities of life. Sometimes we doubt if God is listening to us when we pray. We're not always sure if he hears us. Sometimes we doubt the power of God. We doubt that he's able to do what he says he can do. Sometimes we even doubt the love of God. We wonder if he really loves us as much as he says he does. Sometimes we even doubt the existence of God and Jesus. Seriously, haven't most of you probably at one time said, "You know, I just wish Jesus would just walk in the doors and just stand here, you know, like he did to Thomas. And then I would believe and all my doubts would be gone." The good news is, as Jesus did not condemn Thomas for his doubts, neither does Jesus condemn us for our doubts. When Thomas would not believe until he saw Jesus and was able to touch his side and see the scars, Jesus was more than happy to come to him and show him. He wanted to relieve him of his doubts. One of my most favorite stories in the Bible about doubt is in the book of Judges. It's chapter 6, and I wanted to share it with you. And you may have heard this story before. In fact, you probably have, but it's just a wonderful story, and I try to remember it a lot when I start doubting, that God really does want to come to us and help relieve our doubts. Well, an angel of the Lord appeared to a man named Gideon. The Lord told Gideon that he was supposed to rescue Israel from the Midianites. Gideon was immediately concerned because his tribe that would be doing this was the weakest tribe, he said, and he himself was the least important member of his family. And of course, you know what the Lord said when he said that, "I'll be with you," right? Isn't that what God always says in the Bible when people say, "I can't do it"? He said, "I'll be with you." Same words he says to us today when we say we can't do it. Gideon replied, "Give me some proof that you really are God." He just wasn't sure. Gideon doubted. He doubted if the words that he heard were really the words from God. So Gideon prepared some food, some meat and bread, and he placed the food on a rock outside, and this angel of the Lord that had been talking to him took a stick and touched the bread and the meat, and it burst into flames. So Gideon at that point realized that it was the Lord's angel that had come to talk to him and that God was speaking to him. But this reassurance was not enough to erase Gideon's doubts about the Lord's promise to be with him when he went to invade these foreigners. Gideon said to God, I quote, "You say that you have decided to use me to rescue Israel. Well, I am putting some wool on the ground where we thresh the wheat. If in the morning there is only dew on the wool and not on the ground, then I'll believe that you really are going to help me." So the next morning when he got up, that is exactly what happened. When he got up, he squeezed the wool, the Bible tells us, and wrung enough dew out of it to fill a bowl with water. The lamb, when he squeezed this fleece, lots of water came out. But the ground, when he touched it, was completely dry. So wouldn't that be enough to convince you? God did just what he asked. He asked for some proof that God was who he said he was, that he'd do what he said he would. He showed him. He did exactly what Gideon asked him. But this is what Gideon said next, which I find extremely bold. "Don't be angry with me, God, but please let me make one more test with the wool to be sure you're really who you say you are and that you're really going to do what you say." This time he said the opposite. He said, "Have the fleece, the wool be dry, but the ground be wet with dew." So sure enough, the next morning when he got up, the fleece was completely dry and the ground was wet. Finally, Gideon believed that God would do what he said he would do. So this particular story tells me that isn't God patient? I mean, God, the creator of the universe, and to have somebody really question him three times and God willing to prove himself to him. So I remember that again whenever I have doubts that God wants to help us. In fact, I believe doubting is okay. Nowhere in the Bible does it say to be doubt-free. Jesus did say to Thomas, today in our lesson, you know, go and believe and don't doubt. But those are like words of encouragement, you know, believe in me and don't doubt. It's what God wants for us, but he certainly doesn't condemn us for doubting. A book called Myth of Certainty, it was written by Daniel Taylor, chooses to use the term reflective Christians instead of doubting Christians. That sounds a little more positive, doesn't it? We are reflective Christians, we're not doubting Christians. But it's a kind of a good idea. When we have doubts, we need to think about them and reflect and search out those doubts. Again, God is not offended by our doubts, and God certainly does not love us less because we doubt. It's very true that there's nothing we can do to make God love us more, but there certainly is nothing we can do, including doubting, that will make God love us less. When we have doubts about God and our faith, God wants us to look for answers and to be honest and open about those doubts. The quest to find answers to our doubts has a possibility of helping us to grow in our faith. Frederick Buechner, he's a writer and an ordained Presbyterian minister, wrote these words, "Doubt is the ants in the pants of faith." He says that doubt keeps faith awake and moving. And Paul Tillich wrote, "Doubt isn't the opposite of faith, it is an element of faith." Thomas had the courage to be open about his doubts. He didn't try to hide them or he didn't seem to be ashamed. He tested the truth of what he had been told. He used his doubt to seek out the risen Christ to experience him for himself. We can do the same when we have doubts. We can seek out the risen Christ, granted not in the same way that Thomas did, but we can seek out Jesus through prayer. I think that's the number one thing when you have doubts, go to God in prayer. Ask God to help you with your doubts. Also, when you doubt, you can go to the Word of God for words of assurance. We heard today this part toward the end of the gospel lesson. In his disciples' presence, Jesus performed many other miracles which were not written down in the book. But these, meaning other miracles, like what we had just read about, Jesus being resurrected and all the healings, have been written in order that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through your faith in him you may have life. So right there it tells me that the Word of God is there for us to read, especially when we have doubts, to reassure us through God's Spirit. As we read it, we can be reassured and our doubts relieved. Also, what we can do when we have doubts is to seek other Christians for support. That's what we're here for. You know, we should be able to stand up and say, you know, I have some doubts about God. You know, I really do. And all of us gather together and support each other. Whatever doubts you have, you can be sure another Christian has had that same doubt. In Hebrews 10:25, we are encouraged to meet together so we can encourage one another. That includes questions and sharing your doubts with one another. Another thing that's very helpful for with you for you when you doubt is to read books by Christian authors who are honestly and open about their doubts and write about them. There's some wonderful books. Lee Strobel, maybe you've heard of that author. At one time, he was editor for the Chicago Tribune, and he was declared atheist. That was what he told people when they asked what his belief was. He said he was an atheist. Well, his unbelief ended in 1981 with his conversion to Christianity, which was in part influenced by his wife's conversion, but also his personal investigation into the historical scientific evidence for Christianity. He spent quite some time, in fact, I think it said almost 2 years, contacting scholars. He talked to people that really studied the Bible in depth, asking them about the gospel and the portrayal of Jesus and the historic Jesus. Spent a lot of time searching out evidence, and he finally came to the conclusion that, yes, Jesus was real, and he was became a Christian. The book that he wrote all of his findings in is called The Case for Christ. And C.S. Lewis, many of you have heard of that author, wrote Mere Christianity and, of course, a lot of other books. He was raised a Christian, but in his teens, he said he abandoned Christianity. Just had a lot of negative feelings about Christianity, so he walked away from it. And it wasn't until he was in his 30s, like 15 years later, that he acknowledged a belief in God and Jesus Christ again and started practicing his faith. He said his reconversion to Christianity was accompanied by many, many doubts, inward debates, and discussion with friends. And it just isn't adults who doubt, you know, even children sometimes do, as the following story illustrates. There was this little boy, he was in the kitchen with his mother, and it was toward evening, it was dark, and she happened to drop a glass, and the broom that she needed to sweep it up was on the back porch. So she asked him if he would just go out on the back porch and get the broom for her so she could sweep up the glass. He hesitated a little, kind of showing his fear of the dark. His mother said, you know, you don't have to be afraid. Jesus is with you. You have nothing to fear. Just open the door, go out there and get the broom and bring it to me. I need it. She said, because he was still a little afraid, she said, Jesus is everywhere. You know, do you have any doubt about that? The little boy thought for a moment. Then without answering his mother, he went over to the door, cracked it open just a little bit, and he yelled out, Jesus, if you're out there, will you hand me the broom? In a way, Thomas has done us all a favor. He has given us permission to verbalize our doubts. Through Thomas's interaction with Jesus, we have seen how our Lord is not put off by our doubts, but is willing to show himself to us. So whatever your doubts are with regard to God and your faith, know that God really does want to help you. He wants to relieve those doubts. Certainly, God understands that doubts will arise. It doesn't mean at this very moment, if you're doubt-free, that tomorrow you won't be. As circumstances change in our life, sometimes doubts do arise. Yet God wants to help us move beyond our doubts. He doesn't want us to stay that way. My prayer is that when doubts arise, you will face your doubts, and I pray that through your questioning and your doubts, you will find God to be faithful to his word, and in the process, you will draw even closer to the one who gave his life for you. And all God's children said, amen. I would ask the ushers to come forward, please, and remember this is our time to get our Native American Ministry Sunday offering, if you're called to do that. Thank you. Please join me in praying our prayer of dedication. God of life and hope and joy, you have blessed us in ways that go beyond our understanding. Were we to count your gifts to us, we could number the stars of heaven. Please accept the gifts we bring to you as tokens of our love and seeds of blessing for those who have yet to discover your love and grace. Amen. Thank you. We are now going to sing, Easter People, Raise Your Voices. Thank you for joining us for worship today, and we do invite you back next Sunday. Go in peace. May the love of God, the grace of Jesus Christ, and the power and comfort of the Holy Spirit be with you this day and remain with you always. Amen.